I could never go on. I wouldn't take one without you. I don't have the strength to make it on my own. The love of my life, you are the hope that I cling to. You mean more than this world to me. I won't trade you for silver or gold. I won't trade you for riches untold. You are my everything. Thank you, Jesus. Lord Jesus, we declare that right now. You are everything to us, Lord. We cannot compare silver or gold with you, O God. We cannot take a single step without you, O God. We have no strength to go on unless you become our strength, O God. You are the wind beneath our wings, O God. You are our strength. You are our treasure. You are our joy, our increasingly great reward. Thank you, Lord, because you continue to increase. And you're such an amazing reward, O God, that if we have nothing else apart from you, you are enough. Lord God, thank you for helping us to get to that realization over time that if all you have is God, then you have all that you need. God, you are everything, absolutely everything. Lord, how we pray for revelation, O God, that many would walk in revelation, O God, and all Christians would walk in revelation of how complete you are. You are truly everything, O God. There is nothing that we can need. There is nothing we can ever want that can be found outside of you, O God. Everything we need is found in you. You are amazing, Father, because you never change. And yet with every situation, you become the great I am in that situation. You become Jehovah Jireh in that situation. And everything we need is truly, truly is found in you, O Lamb of God, that takes away the sins of the world. You're the same one that sent a ram right beside Abraham when he was ready to sacrifice his son, his promised child, O God, that came at old age. And you looked down from heaven and you saw. You saw what it was going to cost him. You saw the pain it was going to take him through. You saw the trauma. You saw everything, oh God. And you provided a ram. We worship you. We praise you. We magnify you, oh God. Oh, Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Take your place tonight in this service and be glorified. Whatever it is that your people need, whatever it is, oh God, that they require. Thank you, Lord, that you're coming and showing yourself in that place. Thank you, Jesus. We praise you, exalt you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, wow. Why do we cry when we pray? We cry when we pray because of the move of the Holy Spirit. That the Holy Spirit moves in a powerful way. And you can't help but cry as you receive great revelation and think about the goodness of God. There is someone who sang Imela, the song Imela, and said, when I think upon your goodness and your faithfulness each day. Another one sang about, hear these praises from a grateful heart. Each time I think of you, the praises start. And that's it. The moment when you have a revelation of what God has done, when you have a revelation of even just the cross of Jesus Christ, even if you're living in a shack, even if you're living on the streets, when you have a revelation of who God is and what God has done, then you begin to worship him for who he is. God is amazing and God is great. We'll begin tonight by welcoming you. So welcome to the house of the Lord. Welcome to the feet of Jesus, where we are all sitting and learning from the Holy Spirit. This is Open Heavens. If this is your first show, karibu sana. Normally, we encourage you to get a cup of tea so that when we go on break, you know, you're not left there. And I'm like, where are you guys? Yes, you're getting your cup of tea and just to get comfortable. And this is a show that you can have together with your children. Thank you. This is a show you can have together with your little ones and grow together. It's a family service. All right. So tonight the Lord has asked me to speak to begin with about useless faith. And, you know, when I told the crew the title, they said, useless faith? I'm like, yeah, useless faith. They're like, useless faith? And I had to tell them, you'll have to wait for the service to begin so that you can know what useless faith is. I hope you've had a blessed week so far. And we're looking forward to seeing those of you that come to our, sorry, allow me to just log in so that I can keep up with the comments and all that. And at least we can try to be interactive. Mm. Yeah, so I hope you've had a blessed week. I would love to know how your week has been. I'd love to know how you're doing. I'd also love to hear how this show and especially, you know, the teachings are changing your life. Testimonies are powerful. They're a way of glorifying God. It's not to show off or even to praise the person who's ministering. It's one of the ways of overcoming the enemy and also to encourage one another. I like to sing the song, "If he did it for me, he can do it for you." Okay? So it's one of those things in testimonies. And my network has just completely refused to get on. Very strange. All right, we'll keep moving. Anyway, and it will... Oh, there it is. Okay. So when we say we'll keep moving... Then, there we go. Okay. Alrighty. There we go. So we've got 49 people on, a number of people still coming on. Karibuni, karibuni. Oh, Joanne says she's had such a blessed week. Amen, Joanne. Bitu Amoyo says, beautiful setup too. Thank you, Lord. Amen. We are growing, Amoyo. We are growing. We bless the Lord. And of course, we've had Marie here saying, my work is done. The artist that she is. And a big thank you to our host who prefers to remain anonymous so that the Lord can just bless her in that way. Wawira Wamurioki says, glory, glory, glory. He is God and he reigns forever. I can feel your joy, Wawira. Very exciting. Alman Junge, a regular here. May it work. It may be my network. Alma, just speak to it in the name of Jesus Christ, okay? And then Grace Kiambi says, amen. Grace Kiambi again, amen. And then Glenn Miner, woo! Yeah, Glenn, I hope you have a testimony. I would love to hear, inbox me on how things went the other day. Jeb Korir is on as well. Karibu sana mami, thanking God for your testimony yesterday. And I'm still reeling from that testimony. Noni Kuria, karibu sana, saying amen. If you don't comment, I can't see you, okay? So, you know, and some of you are very quick to tell me, even when we meet face to face, you say, I'm not one of the ones who comment, I'm one of the ones who peeps. And may the Lord bless you as you peep as well. And hopefully you get onto the field soon, okay? Joyce Mashari Ogola says, hi there. Hi, Joyce. Hi. Liz Kagesha, Liz, is the J silent or is it Jliz? Okay, so Liz Kagesha says, my spiritual has really grown in Jesus through you, Pastor. Amen. We bless the Lord. Joyce Ogala is like, who is cooking now? Yeah, somebody's cooking now. Yeah, you noticed. Yeah, somebody's cooking. Susan Nyambura, watching from Saudi Arabia. Blessings to you, Susan Nyambura. May you see the Lord in that nation and may you grow in leaps and bounds. I hear you in the future just saying how you grew in that nation because God visited you personally. Glenn Miner says, I can see a chef preparing dinner. Chef, you have fans. Amen. Masi Wakibia. By the way, guys, this is all my house. I would love to really like floss and say, yeah, but tutafika, tutafika. We are heading there. I'm catching this vision. Okay. So Glenn Miner can see a chef preparing dinner. Masi Wakibia says, beautiful home. Amen. I'm sure the owner of the home has heard. Nema Komora, me and my baby girl are waiting eagerly. Oh, sweetheart. Yeah, awesome. You be blessed. And then Lili Gasheri Wakeho says, watching from Iraq. God is good. Amen. Oh, we adore you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. And Kenyan's just amazing. And if you're not Kenyan and you're watching, we love you too. And, you know, it just amazes me how Kenyans get to different parts of the world. And God just grows them and they're used so powerfully. And it's part of what the enemy is trying to fight about this nation. You know? Yeah? All right. There's two more check-ins. So Gina Wambingu Omone saying checking in. Amen. Uh-huh. Gladys Kamau. Pasi, I'm going through a lot. Oh, sweetheart. May the Lord encourage you, Gladys. These two shall pass. These two shall pass. And just remember, we are refined through the fire, okay? We're refined through the fire. You can inbox me. If you don't find a response, send me a message to the number that is not on our screen tonight. Is it on our screen? Okay, they'll put it on the screen, okay? So normally a text or a WhatsApp normally works faster. Okay, Gladys, but may the Lord just step into that situation. Father, just... reach out to your child right now and anyone who's going through a lot, my Father, my God, let them know that it will pass. Diana Powell says, Hi there. God bless you for the work you're doing. Amen, my sister. Amen. We give God glory. Keep praying with us. Keep praying with us to represent the Lord well and also just to remain obedient to the Lord. He's doing great things. He's lifting us up so fast. It's actually shocking. Just pray with us that our eye remains on the giver and never on the gift. Long enough. The gift should just be long enough to praise the Lord. Masi Mukangai says, this is my first time on this show. Amen. Oh, is somebody peeping? Sorry, guys, don't write those things. I'll say them. We have an open book. I'll just say. Oh, gosh. Now, imagine there's somebody behind me, like, you know, those things of Kina and TV, where they're doing that, and someone is like this. Come on, video, come on, drama. This is so cool. Amen. Kulola Joy says, watching. Oh, Kulola, it was so nice doing my three route with you, my sister. God bless you. Let's keep moving. Amen. First time, Masi Mukangai, I was inviting you. Karibu sana. Please try and watch the other videos, Masi Mukangai, just slowly and catch up and you know all that. Yeah, so Susan Gillian says, watching from Hafal, Baltin. Where is that, darling? Where is Hafal? Baltin, whoa, okay, we learn something every day. Susan Gillian, are you the one who called Norway another name over there or Sweden another name over there? Are you playing with us again, Susan? All right, Wangeshi Wambugu, when you sit at his feet, he never, absolutely, freshness every day, freshness. Then Ogola says, the way you love the Lord challenges me. Thank you. You have no idea how much you bless me, by the way. Let me tell you, I love Jesus. I love Jesus. The moment I got to learn that I can pour all this love I have in my heart to him, and he'll never let me down. He'll never play me. He'll never do funny things. He'll never not turn up. He'll never, you know, yes. I have a lot of love to give, and for me, I just give completely to the Lord. Agrippa says, my love is contagious. Amen. Natasha Joy says, watching from Somalia. Wow, powerful, powerful. Natasha, you've been praying about Somalia. If you can hook us up with, you guys stop sending laughy faces. The last time you sent laughy faces, I couldn't stop. Okay. So, Natasha Joy, if you can hook us up with a Pentecostal pastor in Somalia, I really have a burden for Somalia. I've carried the burden for like 3 years, but I don't know where to begin. Glamina says, I'm blessed, pastor. I'm physically healed. Praise God. This page has been a blessing to our family. There was also an interview, Glenn Minor. Would love to hear about that as well. Masha Mapezi is watching with apostrophes. Rachel Nyaga watching. Kate Kinyua tuned in. Vanessa Chastit watching from. Aki, you're playing with me. Seriously, which flag is this? Aki, this is when I wish my husband was here. Yeah, Kozimi gets flags. Yeah, she's watching from a flag that has red and white and all that. I'm a bit blonde with flags. Then Jerry Muturi has just joined. She was cooking very quickly. Ariana says hi. Okay, Ariana, I believe you. You're a little prophet. Yes. Rachel Aundo is watching. Amen. Rachel, thanks for praying with us and just standing with us. Such a sweetheart. And then Florence Masharia, watching from Finland. Wow, powerful, powerful. And Karanja Ann, watching from Bahrain. Kenda Katrina is tuned in. You guys, if you can just click share, then it will go to your entire platform and we can minister to more people. Thank you, technical team. I can see they've put the number that you can contact us on or text us on, or you know, yeah. I'm not very good with phone calls just yet. I believe from January I will be. Yeah, somebody's sending laughing faces. All right, guys. So the first thing that God asked me to minister on today is about sorry, my nose just runs a lot when I'm ministering because I just have so much emotion and, you know, just the love of God and the moving of the Holy Spirit. So the Lord asked me to minister about useless faith. How dare you, Apostle, call faith useless? Now, faith is a substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. That's what Hebrews tells us. But what is useless faith? Useless faith is the kind of faith that expects that without the power of the cross, you can still benefit from the work of the cross. Without the work of the cross, you can still benefit from the power of the cross. I'll tell you exactly where this word came from. So after we did route Mark 3, you know, by the way, I've been negotiating with God about Mark 3 for ages. I've been negotiating with God on Mark 3s. I'm like, God, really, really? What if someone sees me? God, Mark 3, seriously, Mark 3 preacher? And the Lord says, go, go, go. And then street preacher, I'm like, oh God, really, seriously? The Lord Bible says go. I said, okay, fine, Lord. I'll lay down my pedo, my pice, my poshness for you. You know, anything for you, Lord, so long as you've told me to go and I'm not hearing my own things. But then Rutma 3 was very, very powerful. The Lord really moved. And I believe that lives were changed. And we'll just keep going as we go along. All right. So when I was coming from the Rutma 3, we stopped by somewhere to buy some really yummy looking oranges. So when we stopped to buy, as we were buying them, first of all, the price was really, I mean, it's amazing to shop in town. Eh? I've not shopped in town like for ages. I mean, you find, what was it, tangerines for like 20 bob. You're like, really? Really? Yeah. So we were buying them and, you know, how much was it? No, it was not 20 bob. It was 50 bob. It was 50 bob. So then as we were buying, we're like, okay, yeah, put. And then I asked the mother, are you born again? And she says, she looked at me and she couldn't say anything. I love that, by the way, when you ask somebody whether they're born again and they are unable to cook, you know. So she's like, she just looked at me and she's like blank face. So I said, the reason I'm asking you is we've just come from preaching. We've passed a whole lot of tangerines and oranges, and God must love you a lot because we felt led to stop here. And she started saying, yeah, in fact, I've just opened my work. It's true. God really loves me. Da, 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 da. Then we moved, we moved. Then as we were buying stuff, I told her, you really need to give your life to Christ. What stops you? Then, you know, you could see she was getting a bit uncomfortable and everything. I told her, we've just come from ministering the gospel. Hopefully we'll see you again, but you need to know that the Lord has stopped us by your stop. For me, I believe every opportunity you get to preach the gospel, you use it. And especially in a situation where you've passed many stalls and stopped at this one, then the Lord has visited the person because, you know, you felt led to spend the money that actually belongs to God in this particular shop. So anyway, we packed a whole bunch of things. And then when we were leaving, she said something like, yeah, God loves me. God has blessed me so much. God is doing so much. And I said, you need now to give your life to God so that he can, you know, you as an act of obedience. Then she said, hey, it's true, you know. Then I didn't feel the witness in the Holy Spirit telling me to lead her to Christ at that moment. So as we were leaving, I said, today, you're going to sell a lot. I felt led to prophesy on her. I said, today, the Lord is going to visit you in a heavy way, and you're going to sell a lot, that you will not forget us. I gave her my card, and I said, you will remember us. And at the end of that remembering, you'll remember that I told you, you need to give your life to Christ. You need to make that intelligent decision, and then see how much more God's going to do for you, because God has visited you today. Then she said, katika jina la Yesu, in Jesus' name, katika jina la Yesu. And I turned, and I just heard the Lord saying, useless faith. Now, what is this useless faith? Because it's something I've thought about through the week. And I've been hearing that word, you know, for the last 7 days or so. Seven, let's say 8 days or so. Useless faith. Useless faith. I'm like, huh? Holy Spirit, what are you saying? Let me tell you what useless faith is. Useless faith is, you do not call Jesus Lord, but you can dare say, in Jesus' name, who are you to use the name of Jesus? I'm sorry to tell you that, but it's a fact. In the book of Acts, you find some guys, they are so jazzed by how Paul and Peter and all those guys are casting out demons. So they finally meet this guy and they decide they're going to cast out demons. So they say, come out in the name of Jesus, who Paul preaches. And the demon responds, says, Peter, I know, Paul, I know, but who are you? They were beaten until they ran out naked. They were beaten until their clothes fell off. You can imagine what kind of kichapo cha kinyama, or what is it called? Yeah, that is the kichapo. Don't go using the name of Jesus when you don't even know him. Okay, so that's a useless faith. The other useless faith that the Lord is talking about is the kind that takes scripture and quote scripture, and yet you're walking wrong with the Lord. So like the other day, recently, I was dealing with a situation. And I was shocked to see somebody daring to quote a very powerful psalm that is capable of killing or maiming. Yeah? And yet the person is not walking right with God. God had told me, I had rebuked. And then the person goes in there and types this thing and all that. And the Lord told me, useless faith. You cannot use the gospel of Jesus Christ for your convenience. You can't say you're not born again. And the Bible is very clear, and I need to open it. Let's open together to Psalm 91, okay? Psalm 91. So, things are going wrong. There's danger. You're afraid. You're scared. And then, you go saying,
Nothing will happen to us. Psalms 91.
Ooh, Psalm 91. No scripture works, but the scripture is covenant. Eh? Scripture is covenant, and it's covenant for the righteous. And it's not our righteousness, it's the righteousness of Christ. So you cannot go quoting scripture when you have no relationship with God. Okay? And the relationship comes through the Son of God. So let's just read Psalm 91 about you, so that we learn about this useless faith. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High. What is this shelter of the Most High? Another version says in the secret place. The secret place, the shelter of the Most High, is a place of prayer. Spending time with God. Intimacy. Relationship. My Savior. My Lord. The love of my life. So you cannot go quoting Psalm 91 and you can't even remember the last time you prayed. You have no relationship with God. You're not in the secret place of the Most High. The shelter of the Most High is in a place that you can only access by the blood of Jesus Christ. And then it says that you will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. Okay? So the shadow meaning no matter where you go, no matter where you are, you're within the radius of God so that his shadow can cover you. All right? And then, of course, he begins to see all these things. You declare of him, he's my refuge, my fortress. Yeah? The word of God says that the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and they are saved. Okay? Another version says they are safe. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. Another version says the name of the Lord is a fortress. Okay? It's a mighty fortress. So again, verse 2. You know, the word of God is very intertwined. And it's New Testament, Old Testament, New Testament, Old Testament. So this useless faith is where you go saying, in the name of Jesus. And I see some of us writing, IJN, in Jesus' name. How dare you? How dare you summarize the name of my Lord and my God? How can you do that? I mean, if you don't go around saying, it is me, you know, maybe your name is Muthoni Njuguna Odhiambo, yeah? It is me, MNO. It is me, MNO. And how would you feel if someone's like, where? MNO? MNO? We'll even turn. So why do you think it's okay to write IJN in Jesus' name? And I don't know, GBU, God bless you. Really? We summarize the name of God as a small capital G? Really? You know, there's an emerging culture of laziness, which also encompasses HBD. By the way, one of the things I say is don't wish me happy birthday if you're going to write HBD. If I'm not worth you typing happy birthday, which will probably take you 30 seconds to 1 minute, don't wish me a happy birthday. And if I feel that way, I can imagine how God feels as his children are writing IJN. And let me tell you something, no demon's going to run to IJN, okay? No demon's going to run to IJN. And those are the things, useless faith. Useless faith. Why do we shorten the things of God? Why do we not understand that there is power in saying, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Do you know people get healed when you say Jesus? Do you know that people get healed when you declare, call on the name of Jesus? When you just say Jesus, Jesus, something happens. But they have tried it in a room. I think it was a solemn assembly, was it? When we're just saying, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I can say, Jesus, Jesus. You know, you've reached your end. And you don't know how to pray. You don't know what else to say. And all you say is, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Because the name of Jesus has power. And the environment just shifted. The spiritual realm just shifted. And that's also relationship. You know Jesus. And from that place of relationship, chef, your pilipili mengia. Oh, Lord, I have some juice. It's black pepper, I think. It's going to be yummy. We're breaking our fast. So, yeah, useless faith is where, you know, you don't want the relationship with God. You don't want to pay the price. You don't want to walk with God. You don't want to have to follow his commandments. But you're very quick to call Jesus, very quick to quote scripture. You go to church, but you're not making any decision, and you think everything's going to be okay. God did not call us to go to church. God did not call us to have our own self-righteousness. God called us to honor him by accepting the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. When I was trying to understand salvation, when I just come from the Catholic faith, I would try and talk to Catholics about salvation, and it was difficult. So I'm going to share something with you tonight. Here's what God explained to me. You know, in the Catholic faith in those days, we were taught that everyone is saved. Everyone is saved. There was also another version where people get saved every morning, apparently. My mom pulled this one on me, that, you know, I get saved every day. There's no such thing of getting saved every day. God's mercies are new every morning, but we don't get saved every day. We get saved once. Yeah, and the Bible says that for those that get born again, Jesus will present us before the Father on that day. So here's what the Holy Spirit taught me. The Holy Spirit taught me something interesting. That if I come into this place with cake, if I come with cake, and you know, we are about maybe 10 of us here in this room. If I come with cake and three people eat the cake, the seven others cannot say that they have already eaten. The seven others cannot say, ah, all of us had cake. You can only say you had cake if you took the piece, if you bit it, and you chewed it, and you swallowed it. Then you can say you had cake. Then you can even say which flavor it was. Then you can say what texture it was. You can say whether it had stayed for a day or whether it was fresh from the oven. You can say whether it was warm or whatever. But no matter how much the three that ate the cake described the cake, the seven did not eat the cake. And they actually can be said even to have rejected the cake. Salvation is very much the same way. John 3:16, for God so loved the world. So Jesus is a package of God's love, wrapped with a, you know, a ribbon, if you so wish, but definitely not looking so amazing on the old rugged cross. And Jesus came and he was given to us. He walked where we walk. The Bible says because he walked where we walk, you know, he was on earth for 33 years. And because he walked where we walk, because he suffered what we suffered, he went through everything that we went through. He understands the environment that we are in. And by the way, Jesus is the most powerful intercessor, because then in heaven, he's able to be our mediator and to say, you know what, have mercy on her. In this situation, Father, you might not understand, but this is what happens. And, you know, he can try to explain in godly language to the Father about what being on earth is. And through that, again, he applies the blood. And when God looks at your situation and my situation, the Father has mercy yet again. You know, it has been said that when the Father speaks, the Father hardly ever speaks. But when the Father speaks, as he did, you know, when Jesus was, just about to be baptized, people had rumbling. People had rumbling. When the Father told the Israelites, you know, consecrate yourselves, I'll meet with you guys. Just from the thought, as the time was coming, because of his glory and his power, they said to Moses, you know what? You go meet him, then come and tell us. You know, when he would meet Moses at the place of the tent or meeting place that it was called, a cloud would actually descend. And sometimes I kind of wonder, was it a cloud that would descend, or was it their inability with their physical eyes to behold God himself? Remember, when Moses met with God on top of Mount Sinai, when he was getting the Ten Commandments and he really stuck up there, when he came on earth, do you remember what they had to do? His face was shining so bright they couldn't bear it. You know, that is Ruach HaKodesh. That is the glory of God. And if you haven't watched our show, our recording about Ruach, there's actually a recording about Ruach. If you just go to our page, our Facebook page, and go through the videos, you will find a teaching on Ruach, R-U-A-C-H, Ruach HaKodesh. Just by spending time with the Father that much, his face was shining and glowing until they had to cover him with a veil. They couldn't bear it. So, what am I saying? I'm talking about relationship. You know, when you have relationship with God, the faith that you have is not based on what someone else tasted. It's not based on what someone else heard. It's not based on what, you know, is rhetorical or whatever it is. It's based on the God before whom I stand, the God I know. And if you haven't watched that particular one, I think it was last week or the week before? It was on 30th. It was on 30th of October, the Monday, 30th of October, that we did the God before whom I stand. And Elijah talked about the God before whom I stand. So let's not have useless faith. Let's not have the kind of faith that the devil hears you and goes like, what did you just say? You know, or worst case scenario, The devil moves around to demons here and there, and you think it's God who came through for you. And so you continue in the same deceived path where you think you can use the name of a God who you have never accepted. You know, the God of your mom, or the God of your dad, or the God of your sister. It doesn't work that way. Relationship. And the Bible is a covenant. The Bible is actually a covenant. So you cannot, you know, I've heard that some men and women of God say, if you have any doubt, say, you know, I believe it through the name of, say, for example, Apostle Kathy. You can't do that. You can say the name of Jesus, but you have to believe based on your faith. It is done to you according to your faith. But the beauty is, if you have the faith the size of a mustard seed, which is a really tiny, tiny, tiny little thing, just a little faith. But you need to give your life to Christ. You need to be saved. You need to be saved. You know, some of us attend church. Some of us are so religious until nobody can even preach to them because you sound like you're saved, you know. And there's such, it's become such a thing that it's posh-ish to throw in religion here and there, to saying God cannot agree, to say we are praying or whatever, and you have no relationship with God. You know, one of these days, the trumpet will be blown and, you know, we shall be taken up into the air, and you will suffer 7 years and have to give your life to Christ through the cutting off of your head, which is what Revelation says, to be able to get to heaven. Don't get to that. Don't get to that. And I can see my thing has stopped. I don't know why. Yeah, so thank you, Julia. I'm just seeing your comment right now. Scripture is covenant. It is. Scripture is covenant, okay? Testament means covenant. The old covenant and then the new covenant, yeah? The Old Testament, the New Testament. The New Testament is based on the blood of Jesus Christ. The old covenant is based on all the promises, the Abrahamic covenant, the Davidic covenant and all that. And imagine, you guys, the beauty of the cross, and this is why I cry. As a result of having given our lives to Christ, do you know we just come in? We are partakers of all those covenants. I think the last time I counted them, there were like 5. We are partakers of all those covenants, the Davidic covenant, the, I don't know if I can find them very quickly. Let me just see if I can find them. I was preaching on covenants sometime, and I need to go back there and preach on that again. Let me see if I can find covenants on my notes. Thank God for these gadgets. Huh? You can search stuff and find it. I want to just tell you what covenants we have. Covenant. Okay, here we go. So, I need to really just teach on this on its own, but I'm just trying to get us out of the useless faith. Eh? Okay, I have a whole bunch of scriptures, but I'm not finding the summary. Okay, I think I've been teaching a lot about covenant. Dear God, help me. I really need to teach on this, don't I? So there's the Davidic covenant, there's the Abrahamic covenant, then there's the new covenant. Not finding them. Maybe it's on my phone. Anyway, so there are like 5 of them. There's the Mosaic Covenant as well. So there are about 5 of them that are listed. I will teach one of these days. I'll just prepare myself and come and teach on that. But very, very powerful, because something like the Abrahamic Covenant is a covenant of increase. It's a covenant of increase. It's a covenant of life that continues and goes on and on beyond even ourselves. And those are things that we are partakers of. Why does my thing keep going off, guys? Something's happening to my thing. Anyway, no, the devil is just a liar. Last night I was speaking with somebody on the phone, and very high-level statesperson who was just had called me to pray with her and everything. And you know, those phone calls that you're like, wow. Yani, God, this person even knows that I exist. And it was very surprising on Saturday night. It was very surprising. Thank you. Thank you so much. It was very surprising that at one point she said, you know, it's crazy, but all I'm hearing is whoa, 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 whoa. And the devil is just He interferes like that with our platforms, and you know, but he's already defeated. It's one of the warfares that we deal with as Sozo Church. So if you deal with that, just rebuke in the name of Jesus Christ and deal, because I mean, my phone is completely blank, totally gone, blank, there, blank screen, ridiculous. Anyway, but we still go on. Amen. So just moving away now from useless faith, now that we've learned about useless faith, talking to some about something that I love so much, and this is about revival. And the Lord has released revival already, and is calling us to believe and to desire revival. And one of the things that I've struggled with in terms of calling for revival is that I honestly believe that people don't know what revival is. And that's why they don't want revival. And let me tell you how I began to teach. For in 2014, 2013 and 2014, I had a ministry team. We would meet at lunchtime, sometimes in the morning, but meet at lunchtime for sure, and then meet in the evening. And all we did, there were no prayer items, there was nothing. And you know, in Sozo, we had, at that point, we didn't even own a chair. But we would just cry for revival. Because in 2012, the Lord put in my heart a burden for revival. And he gave me such a revelation on what revival is and the power of revival. And from there, I've just, you know that thing you want to put aside and you can't put aside? And I'm hoping that tonight the Lord will help us to understand what revival is, that we may desire revival more than we desire anything else. So I'd been praying 2012. 2013, crying for revival, but I looked for books, I looked for things. All I could find was like the Fiji revival. There was a video, there was a revival, a video on the Azusa revival, but all of them were talking about the what happened after revival, not really how do you get revival. So, you know, I remember being at Keswick Bookshop so many times, by the way, that even when I began to speak online, the lady there who was serving me, she found my number and texted me and told me, I hope you remember me from Keswick. And I was so new in ministry. And I went and I said, I just want a book about revival. She says, what? So I'm like, yeah, I just want a book about revival. She says, we don't really have a book on revival. But would you like to read about the generals? Would you like to read about? So there was a book about God's generals who brought in revival. But it talks about what they did right and what they didn't do right. But it doesn't talk about their journey. But here's the thing. Very often, the people who usher in revival don't get to be known until revival comes. So people find them, discover them, you know, like the way Africa was discovered, like we were never there. So anyway, they are discovered after revival. That's when people get to know that person. And so by that time, no one has really recorded. So part of what we began to do in Sozo, and this is part of it, even the video and everything, is we are recording the process of revival. You know, that there may be that thing about revival and the process of revival as we go forward. So what did I have to do? I had to go back to the Holy Spirit. I said, okay, we can't seem to find anything, but you are there. So you're the teacher. The Bible says that you are my teacher. So you teach me, because you can't put the desire for revival in my heart and not give it to me, you know? One of the things I've learned to say, I say in my mother tongue, is Gaida Shume Kanagia. God does not do for you, nye, 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 nye. Then when you go to bite, he pulls away, you know? So it's one of the things I say. So I'm like, God, you don't shume care people, so you introduced revival to me. I didn't go looking for it. So you show me the process of revival. So all these recordings are also just the journey to revival. But in 2014, yes, I have the date. Hallelujah. I actually wrote it down. I wrote it on my Bible. In 2014, on the 13th of January 2014, God gave me... You know now, guys, by the way, I'm understanding that thing that you guys normally see. Your screen has gone blank. But you can hear a voice. Somebody's laughing. So I can see your comments. I can see or whatever, but my screen is blank. But at least I have two screens. I thank God. So in 2014, on the 13th of January, I was praying. And the Holy Spirit began to tell me, this is how revival flows. Okay? And in just... So I'll do an intro, then we'll take a break. Okay? So God gave me four particular points that are critical in revival. And then after that, he gave me the results. So he gave me scripture, he gave me four particular points, and called it in the pursuit of revival and what needs to happen for revival to come. So just after the break, we'll go back to what is revival and then come to the 4 points. And then if time allows, we'll do the 6 points. And if not, we will continue next week. Amen. We'll be right back. All right, welcome back. Okay. I hope you got a chance to dash somewhere and do something, at least in the break. So welcome back. So we're talking about revival now. We're talking about useless faith earlier on. If you're just joining us, karibu sana. You will need to go back to replay to be able to keep up with what we're discussing, especially the useless faith. If you're like, huh, useless faith? Yes, it is useless faith. And by the way, on that same note of useless faith, can we stop this thing of trying to make people feel okay with their faith that are not going to lead them to heaven, at least so that they don't feel bad? If you love someone, you need to tell them that Jesus is the only way, the truth, and the life. And like I said earlier on in my post, I went to Catholic schools from when I was in class 4 all the way to form 4. And there were 2 different schools, but one thing in common that they had, let me tell you, in a Catholic school, there's no Muslim who's going to pray. There's no traditionalist who's going to pray. There ain't no Protestant who's going to pray. They're the ones who pray. They're the ones that lead the prayers. They're the ones that do everything. And they're convinced
that that is the faith. And I really admire that side of Catholicism, in terms of, you know, they don't do that thing of trying to make everybody feel comfortable and all that. And really, those who are called Protestants, I don't believe we're Protestants, because we're not protesting nothing, but the Christians, those who are born again, those who are of the household of faith, we need to stop doing that, manenos, okay? Because then we're telling people it's okay to follow whatever you believe, ask us, I'm going to go to heaven, but, you know, who knows? Maybe your way could be, you know, and I've had people say there are different routes. And just like going to town. Jesus is the only route. He's the only way, the truth, and the life. I didn't say it. The Bible says it. Okay. So back to revival. So in terms of revival, what is revival? Revival is simply put a heavy outpour of the glory of God. A heavy outpour of the glory of God. You know, we sing, open the floodgates of heaven, let it rain. That's revival. That's what we are calling for. It's a heavy outpour of the glory of God. It manifests in different ways. But one thing that the glory of God does is that it changes every place it goes to. If you look at the Fiji revival, you know, the Fiji revival began as a result of a political crisis. And that's why I think that our political crisis right now is a fantastic opportunity for revival, because trouble makes us run to God. And whenever Christians are persecuted, whenever Christians are in trouble, whenever things happen to Christians, a lot of times revival falls because we turn to God wholly and completely, because then if we don't, we will be destroyed. So in Fiji, they had a political stalemate, like, you know, the kind of stalemate that we are having right now. But the opposition decided, I hope I don't give anybody ideas, but they decided to go and lock the ruling party inside parliament. And basically they were to starve, and they were not going to come out, they were not going to order pizza, they were not going to order yams or anything at all, unless they agreed with the opposition. Yeah. So basically the opposition was being tyrannical, and the ruling party was being difficult, and that's what they did. So as that thing happened and there was this whole thing going on, then the Methodist Church realized that there was a problem. Chef. Okay, the chef is really cooking. Anyway, I hope the sound is okay, guys. You know, we're not all cooking. All right, cool. So because of the political atmosphere and what was going on, the Methodist Church was like, oh my God, you know, like the way right now our bishops have suddenly realized and all these guys have realized we're having a problem. And it's so unfortunate how the church unfortunately comes out in the midst of crisis instead of ruling on our knees in advance. So as a result of the crisis, the Methodist Church says, ah, yeah, no one is coming across. So the Methodist Church rose up and began to call prayer meetings, and they began to pray. Then the Methodist Church got in touch with, I think, other churches, and they began to join churches. And the thing with revival is that revival doesn't come to just one church. The revival comes as the church unites as a body of Jesus Christ, not denominations. And as they began to pray, God told them, okay, fine, you are having this political situation, but that is just like the leaves. You know, one of the things I've been teaching is, to be able to deal with a spiritual problem, you need to find the root. Otherwise, you'll just be fiekaing, you know, slashing. And if anything, the two demons are like, woohoo, we have new roots, we are growing, you know. Ah, we are sprouting, and you're wondering, why is this problem getting bigger? It's because you're just pruning. So what you need to do in the spiritual realm always is to find out the root of the problem. Then you deal with the root, then the whole tree or the branches and everything will just collapse and they'll die. And it cannot gain ground again because the roots are dead. So these guys, as they prayed, the Holy Spirit led them to the root. So they were told that the root of their problem was hatred. So us guys have had tribal division, and they had racial division. It has gone back. Somebody just take it back and just maybe, yeah. Yeah, so they had racial division, and we have been having tribal division. So what happened with them? They were caught up in a situation where they hated the Asians, because the Asians were doing business and thriving and everything. So at one point in all their chaos and their fights, they decided to ban businesses that belong to Asians. Does that sound familiar? Does that sound familiar? God hates hatred. And Asians, even though they are not born again, God still looked out for them and told them, now, you guys, this is injustice, and you know, I'm a God of justice. So I expect that you will be just in everything that you do so that I can be able to bless you. And that's how you know, they were told by God, this is one of the things that Satan is using to accuse you. You know, we've talked about the courtrooms of heaven, and one of the things Satan does is that he's very good at accusing. In fact, the Bible says he accuses day and night. So as he's accusing like that, as he was doing the accusation and everything, then, you know, this whole thing began to manifest. So it's manifesting as a political problem. Thank you. It's manifesting as a political problem, but it's not really a political problem. So what did they do? God told them you have to do something called repentance. So repentance means I'm sorry. That's confession. And then now, never do it again. Okay, so that's the difference between confession and repentance. So in confession, you say, I'm sorry, I did this and that to you. And normally it's best to say, I did this and that. You say it. This is what I did. That is confession. Then repentance means you don't do it again. Okay? So then what they did is that they went to the Asians as a church and they said, we as a nation of Fiji have sinned against you. We've destroyed your businesses. Please forgive us. And then they went, they went and they said, okay, we'd like to help you to rebuild your business. So they put together funds, they collected funds. Of course, this was not overnight. And then they mobilized funds and then they went and they helped to rebuild the businesses of the Asians. And as they were doing that and praying and repenting and calling on the name of God, that's how revival in Fiji fell. You know, the interesting thing is I went to Ethiopia when they had a state of emergency in October last year. And the Lord sent me there during my birthday and, you know, told me with very strict instruction, you cannot tell anybody that this is whatever, this is your birthday and everything you're going to give. I remember people asking me, "Hiya, you're going to Ethiopia with a state of emergency and everything." But I was like, the Lord will watch over me. Psalm 91, he must have known there was going to be a state of emergency when he was sending me there, and I'm going to Ethiopia. And in one particular church, and this church reminded me a lot of Sozo Church, because it was very, that church was full of healing, it was full of deliverance, it was such a sensitive and sweet church, just a fragrance, amazing fragrance. And by the way, as their whatever they were writing at the very top was also about revival, what they had at the very front, same scripture that the Lord had given us. And in that particular church, the Lord told me about I hope I can get it right, there's the Oromo and there's the, oh dear God, I have forgotten. Amharic, Oromo and the Amharic, yeah. So the Lord told me about the two they had been fighting, and the Lord told me to ask them to stand up, and you could see the discomfort. So like where the Oromos, they stand up. Where the Amharic, whatever, and they stand up. And then the Lord told me, now go to the other. And it began with the ones who had actually been killing. The other ones are Debrazite. That's a place. And it's a cyclical killing. It's a cyclical killing. It comes every so often. It comes and it kind of seems to come in the specific length of time. And it was really powerful as the Lord asked us to tell them to go over to the others and, you know, repent on behalf of their tribes. You could feel the glory of God in that church. And God is big on that. And one of these days, my prayer is that those, especially, you know, Kikuyus and Luos have fought for a long time, that there would be that kind of healing, and that pastors, and if you're hearing me, pastors, bishops, etc., that we would have a reconciliation beginning in the house of God, where we'd be able to go to one another and say, you know, we have done to you. And normally, you know, with things like repentance, you stand in the gap. Even if you've never, you know, like for me, I'm in love, madly in love with a Luo man. So I've not done anything to no Luo. But I would go to them and take on the responsibility for what, my tribe has done, and you know, repent and tell them we have done. Then the Luos go to the Kikuyus and we have done. And that's how healing will begin in terms of the house of the Lord. And my prayer is that churches would arise and lead this initiative, and that pastors would begin also amongst themselves, because even in the priesthood there's a lot of division. But then, so revival in Fiji fell. And what happened when revival in Fiji fell? You know, and this reminds me, and the Holy Spirit is reminding me just now, when was it? It was on Thursday, I think. I was at Java. You know, this Java, at the Shell petrol station of Kileleshwa at the bottom where the river is. So as I was standing there, the Holy Spirit told me, instead of waiting for your order, go out there, I'd like you to pray. So I went out there and the Holy Spirit was moving so heavily. So when I got out there, it was a balcony and the river was passing out there. And as I was praying, as I was worshiping him, he asked me, why have you not asked me to clean your river? Do you know I cleaned rivers? I'm like, whoa, Holy Spirit. I believed, yes, that when revival comes, because part of what happened in Fiji is the rivers became clean, so clean that the fish came back into the rivers. Nobody cleaned them. And that's the thing. When the glory of God comes, because God cannot dwell, you know, they say cleanliness is next to godliness. The thing is, God doesn't dwell in an unclean environment, not physically unclean and not spiritually unclean. In fact, a lot of times you'll find that when God is about to do something major in your life, one of the ways it manifests will be, one, diarrhea. Imagine, diarrhea. You can get diarrhea out of nowhere. You're not sick, but you just get diarrhea. You might even be fasting. It's cleansing. The other way that God manifests himself when he's about to show up, and I found this is not anywhere in the Bible, this is just my experience as an intercessor, is through showering. You find you just have a long, you just want to shower for long. And very often when someone calls me and tells me I was on a long shower, I tell them, the Lord is just about to come. And it's not the one where you say, what shall I do today? I know, let me go and shower for long. No, not that one. But the one where you find yourself in the shower and you're scrubbing and scrubbing and scrubbing and you feel like you can't get clean. It's part of a transition of what God wants to do. The other thing that God does is seasons changing and rain comes. And you know, the glory of God just falls. So anyway, hopefully I'm teaching somebody right now. Amen. So revival is a great outpour of God. And in Fiji in particular, when revival poured, their rivers became clean. I don't know about you, but I want to see my rivers clean. I want to be able to catch fish again, not even tadpoles, you know, because we came from fish to tadpoles to, you know, there's nothing to catch. Jualas now, you know, to catch and soil and I don't know, soap and all that. But because of the abundant glory of God, just his presence purifies the environment. So part of things like global warming are finished by revival, you know. Drought, finished by revival. Did you know, by the way, that one of the signs of witchcraft and any form of rebellion is that the land becomes dry? It's one of the signs. It's one of the signs, yeah. And it's some of the things that hit places like, there's some names I cannot say. Seriously, I'm affected by, Ugunja. Yes, there's that place called that. It's got a lot of witchcraft in Siaya areas, a lot of witchcraft. Ukambani was like that, but the Kambas repented a lot, and now you go to Ukambani and it looks different. Nobody irrigated, nobody did anything, they just repented, you know, and most of Ukambani now is very, very green and beautiful. I mean, we like saying win, you know, as we're enjoying them, but that's the thing, repentance, the abundant glory of God, the presence of God, the overflowing glory of God. One of the other things that happened in Fiji is that, you know, crimes fell. So you want to see crime end? Pray for revival. You no one's going to have to do rehabilitation. God himself will do it, because the criminals begin to get saved. The criminals turn to Jesus. The criminals love the Lord and turn to the Lord. And as a result, there is a mass change and they begin to get saved. And you know, with revival, because the glory of God is all over the atmosphere, people begin to be to realize about their sin, to be convicted. People begin to get saved on the streets. People begin to look for a church where they can go to be ministered to because of the glory of God. The glory of God always draws people in. Always. Always, because he created us that way. He created us knowing that we could rebel, but also we just have a natural drawing to God and his presence and his power, and we are just looking for God every time. So when you feel the presence of God, the glory of God, people come. And so in Fiji, the criminals quishad. So suddenly the cops did not have anything to do as such, you know, especially the administration police. So what happened? You know, the cops had to be moved to other things. And then what else? Because there were no criminals and the ones who were in prison were getting saved everywhere. I mean, there was such a revival, even in prisons, you could leave the doors open and nobody would walk out. They would be like, I'm a criminal. I'm a sinner. I have sinned against you, oh God, I have sinned. I deserve to be locked up, oh God, but have mercy on me, you know. Yeah, I'm just being a bit dramatic right now, but you know, it must have been the scenario. The doors are open, but they don't run away because they know they deserve to be jailed. They have confessed, they have repented. And finally, the state looked and said, there are no criminals here. These guys are changed. They're reformed. They are different. They are helpful. They are rehabilitated. And they were released. And believe it or not, and this is a true story, in the 90s, Fiji, all of a sudden, had no criminals on the streets, had no criminals in jail, and the jails were empty. So all the state and the police had to be creative. So they looked and they were like, we need to get some money, we need to keep this place busy so that it doesn't become run down. And you know what they did? They noted that there was a shortage of, you guessed it, people were falling in love. And because of the glory of God, they didn't want to sin. They didn't want to move in with one another. So what did they do? They decided to get married. So people are falling in love and getting married. So if you can't find your mate, you need to pray for revival. Because somehow revival brings mates. Oh yeah, people get married. There are lots and lots of marriage, love. And no, of course, there's no divorce, so the lawyers were running out of money. And lawyers, please don't bind and run us out of revival, because, you know, yeah. And of course, you can imagine the hospitals, people who are walking out, guys who are getting healed miraculously and amazingly. And you know what the police ended up doing? They turned prisons into reception places, as in wedding reception, because there was a shortage. There were not enough churches, there were not enough venues. And that's what happened. Wouldn't you love to see that in Kenya? And that's what I've been praying for the last 5 years, just crying to the Lord. And my prayer is that you join in so that we can all just call to the Lord for revival. Forget our two issues, our two needs, and call to the Lord for revival. What else happened? The farmers are gonna love this one. There was so much food, or maybe not. There was so much food, the prices of food had to drop because there was so much food. Things like carrots and yams became so big. In fact, they record that yams and carrots would come from the soil the size of like a baby's head. They were huge. They could feed, you know, one yam could feed like a family and everything. Food was everywhere. There was just an abundance of food. Because what happens is, remember, 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, turn from their wicked ways, seek my face, I will hear from where? From heaven. And when he hears from heaven, he does what? He heals the land. Yeah, so this is biblical, but literally. Yeah, crops and everything. In the Azusa revival, crops manifested in an amazing way, and I will share with you a small testimony of a lady who shared with us this afternoon. So in the Azusa revival, as they prayed, as they lifted up the name of Jesus, as they spent endless hours in the presence of God, lifting up his name and not noticing that they were lifting up his name for so long and not getting tired because of the glory of God and the manifestation of God and everything. People are being healed and being changed and all that stuff. Miracles are falling without anybody laying hands on them. One of the news that reached them is, oh my God, there's been an outbreak of, I don't know whether it's locusts or armyworms, and it's bad. So they came to be called. So when they came from service, they decided to go over there and go and check out their farms. But here's the interesting thing. Those little pests, you know that devourer story, yeah? That God will rebuke the devourer, literally. So there was a very strange phenomenon. So these two little pests somehow had some kind of intelligence, and they just developed an appetite for farms that were for unbelievers. So... I love how God works, Joe. I love how God works. He changes the taste buds of the twin sex and everything. It changes their vision. Suddenly, so the Azusa revival, guys, their farms are not been eaten. Nothing. Nothing. Not even the cafens. Yeah? It's like their farms were either not there, or suddenly they developed like a taste maybe of licorice or something disgusting to the twin sex. So they're like, or maybe they were just instructed, you cannot touch that one, you cannot touch it. I tell you, when the blood of the Passover lamb is applied to the door of your life, Satan's got nothing on you. He's got nothing on you. The moment you begin to get that revelation, beloved, you will stop weeping, you will stop mourning, and that's when you begin to understand even the apostles. Why? People would jump at them, and then they come out at you. We are rejoicing. I'm feeling up. That's why. Because they had the abundant revelation of, if something comes, Am I walking with God? Yes. Have I sinned? Oh, Father, forgive me. The Holy Spirit, search me, check me. May no sin be found anywhere near me. And then finally, when they find there's nothing, stand firm. And after everything, stand. And that comes through, even revival is a revelation. And I believe what we're seeing on this platform is revival in itself. It's a revelation of who God is. It's an understanding that no matter what may happen, they can take everything away, including my life. But you know what? So long as my Savior still reigns, I have tomorrow. I have eternity. I will be there with the Lord. There is nothing that Satan can do. And you know, in that stage, in that space, you have nothing to lose but back to revival. Ooh, I'm feeling the Holy Ghost. So, Azusa, these guys, seriously, God decides he's going to manifest himself through two little worms or locusts, whatever they were, but they were devourers. And they eat round the farms. Eat round. So you could actually, in Azusa, which is Los Angeles, you could actually tell who was a member of the Azusa revival and who was not a member of the Azusa revival based on they had a farm, it was intact, it was fine. And I know sometimes we don't want revival because it makes us feel naked. Sometimes you don't want revival if you're walking in sin. And let me tell you, when revival falls, it mulikas. You cannot have darkness and light. It's very, very clear. And you know, this is the state that the apostles walked in. I asked the Holy Spirit, how come there's not much of a mention of revival other than, you know, the Pentecost? And then there is repent so that times of refreshing may come to you. And I'm asking the Lord, why isn't there much? Why isn't there much? And maybe Joel too. But why isn't there much talk of revival, especially in the New Testament? And God told me, simply, my apostles walked in a state of revival. So every day was revival for them. I mean, seriously, think about it. Peter walked. And his shadow, his shadow, kivuli, his shadow. The guy was so anointed that his shadow healed people. As in, you're walking, rikashendere, oh, I worship you, Jesus. I love you, Lord. And you're just hearing behind you, hallelujah, I'm healed. Glory to God. I want to see that. I want to see that glory of God. I want to see that manifestation of God. I want to see that kind of anointing. I'm tired of, you know, Mama Mboga, are you born again? And etc. And fine, she balances tears and everything. And that's an anointing in itself. But man, I want to be going and buying the whatever. And as I'm buying, she starts, I want to give my life to Jesus. And by the way, let me tell you something interesting. The first time I did a 40-day fast, I was very, very young. I was 21 years old, and I'd just been reading Benny Hinn's book, Good Morning Holy Spirit. And by the time I reached page 3, I was like, whoa. And I said, you know what, Holy Spirit, I am not eating until this breakthrough comes and I begin to walk in power like this. 40 days and 40 nights. I was on holiday, so I would lie down and just worship the Lord the whole day, cry to him. I'm dry, but I continue. He's not coming, but I continue. It feels like I'm talking to myself, but I continue. And I would be, you know, lie on my side and I cry to the name of the Lord. And I'm like, God, I want to see you. You, Lord, just your glory. Nothing but your glory. Then I turn to this other side. Nothing but you, O Lord Jehovah God. At night, I'm falling asleep. I'm beginning to do that. Oh God, your glory. And that's what I was crying for 40 days and 40 nights, and just calling to the Lord. In those days, cake was rare. And it was around the same time as either it was my parents' anniversary or it was my mom's birthday. I can't remember, but my sister baked a cake. And I remember her passing it in front of me. Ah, you're fasting, cake you'll eat. And she was worried about me because she thought I would die. Because, you know, she's like, 40 days? What do you mean 40 days? You can't do that. You'll die, you know. And, you know, I told her, you know what? The best you can do for me is you freeze that cake, because I'm not going to eat it, even though I'm longing for it. Freeze it anyway. And guys, let me tell you something interesting. After about 14 days, and this was purely just calling on the name of God and nothing else. After about 14 days, the Lord told me, you can take a walk. So I got out of the house and took a walk. Do you know, I met so many people and they'll just stop me. Are you saved? Umeokoka. Out of nowhere. And they were, let me not say nowhere, it's the Lord bringing them. But let me tell you, I just kept meeting people and they were asking me to lead them to salvation. I remember one particular girl, she saw me, she started crying and she knelt down. And that is revival and that is the glory of God. Of course, I was very young and foolish at that time. And when the Lord did what the Lord did, I still didn't get it. So that's my experience of revival in terms of that. So there's Azusa. And then there is Scotland. Which is known very well for its pubs and everything. I was there recently. God made a way for me to go over there. Beautiful place. Oh, beautiful place. In fact, I keep saying, you know, if guys in Kenya won't receive revival, I'm going to Scotland. You know, and and they love, well, they don't love the Lord because a lot of them don't have a revelation of the Lord. But there was a Scotland revival. And you know what? The glory of God was so heavy that there were no pubs no more because there was nobody. And if you don't have a pub, if you don't have people to come and drink, you have to shut down your business. It's not powerful. Where guys of Nairobi West? Say amen. Where else are there pubs? Kile. Kile has started pubs. Yeah! Say amen. I don't know where you're from, which area you're from. Maybe you can just share with us. But that's just to give you a taste of revival. Oh, I have to share this one. So, Azusa, The glory of God was so heavy, and this has come through in different revivals, by the way. The glory of God was so heavy that it manifested on top of the roof of the church as fire. So people kept calling the fire brigade, "There's a fire! There's a fire! Oh yes, there's a fire!" And then the London, at London again. I think I'm prophesying. London Bridge is breaking. Yes. Anyway, so I think I'm prophesying. Oh, in my set. Okay, so. Oh, Father, you have me on a camera. You are God. Hear me. If you never told me that I would be ministering in front of a camera, I would tell you never, ever. Yani, this is obedience. The things I do for the love of my life, Jehovah God. Anyway. I'm all good at lip reading. What are you telling me? But you can't just. It's okay. Oh my God. Some people want us to be perfect, so yes, I will try not to move the set. Let me try and sit myself properly. We're going on. Stop panicking, you guys, and gesturing. Maybe I'm just myself. Now, so, revival. Oh, Jesus. Oh, God. Anyway, no, I'm just having a talk with the Holy Spirit here. So, that's revival for you. So, what scriptures did the Lord give me about revival? To be able to get revival, guys, we can only serve God when we fall to the ground and die. So that's the first thing. We have to fall to the ground and die. And I'm talking about, you know, death of like gone. We're talking about John chapter 12, verse 24. Unless a kernel of seed falls to the ground and dies, it abides alone, okay? So that's what the Holy Spirit told me, and that's the first step. And Galatians chapter 5 as well, Galatians chapter 5, actually the whole of Galatians chapter 5 was another area that God gave me, but to walk in the Spirit, I thought at the time that the Holy Spirit was teaching me that I need to focus on walking in the Spirit, not walking in the flesh, like dealing with the flesh, but I got to learn something, and this was taught to me by the Holy Spirit, that the Spirit was against the flesh and the flesh was against the Spirit. So if you focus on growing your spiritual man, which happens through prayer, through fasting, I know there's some people who pray and fast and there's absolutely no change in their lives. What I'm talking about in prayer and fasting, you have to spend time in the presence of God and just ask God, God, search me. God, search me. God, know me. Are there any wayward ways in my life? Is there something, Lord, that doesn't glorify you? Is there anything, Lord, that doesn't bring you pleasure? The other thing is to get to that place where
you love God so much that you're saying, Lord, you know what? I love to, you know, to shut up and keep to myself and be isolated, but God, you've called me out. But then, you know, one of the things for me that I love, my comfort, a lot of my comfort comes in the privacy of my room. As in, seriously, if I could lock myself in my room and stay there forever and ever and ever, I would. Because like I was telling you, even with the 40 days of prayer and fasting, that's what I did. I was about 20, 21 years old. Whether I was in my room or out of my room, so long as I did my chores, there was no issue at all. And I was able in that place to get whatever, but the Lord calls me out. And part of the reason I was laughing earlier is I'm thinking, seriously, God, you've gotten me to the place where I'm in front of a camera and everything. And that's about falling to the ground and dying. We don't have the luxury, guys, of deciding what we can do with our lives. We don't have the luxury of saying, you know, I'm an introvert, so I'll stick to myself, you know. You don't have the luxury. And by the way, I'm such an introvert, it actually confuses people that I tend to be just an extrovert when I'm around people I'm comfortable with. And of course, most of all, the Lord Jesus Christ. So when I'm in front of a camera, it's Jesus. It's Jesus I'm portraying. It's the Holy Spirit and everything. So that's an anointing. And it confuses people because people come to me like, hi, Pasi, hi. And I'm looking at you like, you know, like, hi, how are you? You know, and it confuses people because they're like, huh? That's when I'm not under the anointing. So you have a heads up, by the way, yeah? So I can be two very different people under the anointing and not, because there are things we'll do as we fall to the ground to serve God and to do for God and to honor God. So unless a kernel of seed of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it cannot rise, okay? So that's about death. So you can go to John 12, verse 24. So the revival doesn't come easy, yeah? Revival doesn't come easy. It's sweat, blood, and tears. Blood is the blood of Jesus, fortunately, not our own. But it comes with being insulted. It comes with being separated. It comes with being in a very lonely corner, because at some point you find out that there's a straight and narrow path and that there are not very many people in it. And so it's not one of those things of, woo, trend. Revival is not like that. Revival is each person getting on their knees and realizing, you know what, I need Jesus. If guys don't need Jesus, me, I need Jesus. As you go to church, it's a thing of, I need Jesus. I need the Lord. I God, if you don't come through for me, you know, and by Friday night, you're there saying, God, I'm meeting you on Sunday in church. And God, if you don't come through for me, I don't know where I'm going to look, because God, you're the one I need. And you're praying and you're crying for that service, to the place where you get to that service. And honestly, if you're the only one on the floor, you know, worshiping the Lord. Yesterday, I had to rebuke the church because a number of people in the church, because man, you know, yesterday, our worship was the best worship we have had the entire year. It was so powerful. I could barely stand. I was sitting most of the time and just, you know, not sitting but lying on the floor most of the time, or kneeling, and I was wailing and wailing, and the glory of God was so heavy. And at one point I remember getting up and stabilizing myself, and then I looked and I could see a number of people in the congregation seated. And here's the thing with God, God can give you your revival because you're hungry. And God has to keep his word. If you draw near to the Lord, he'll draw near to you. So keep moving and stop looking around. Revival is not one of those things where you keep looking around of 20. You don't do that. You go. You keep going with God. Get moving with God. And people will want what you have, or they will come, and revival is contagious. But sometimes not everyone will get into revival. So it's about falling to the ground and dying. It's about forgetting the things that you think are important or whatever it is. And all you want is the glory of God. God, I just want your presence. I want your glory. I want to see you. God, I've read that Moses met you, Lord, and he came out from that mountaintop looking white, oh God. I believe, Lord, you can do it for me as well. And it's not about the looking white, Lord. It's that glory. What did he see? God, I want to see it. God, you said to the Israelites, consecrate yourself. I'll do a new thing for you. Like, God, you know what? I'm not going to enter heaven to find out about you. I want to encounter you such that when I enter heaven, I've already encountered you, and heaven is just me in my perfect body, the one you've given me, the body without sin and everything. And so I can enjoy you fully without, you know, struggling with sin and all those things. But God, I don't want to enter heaven and then be like, oh, this is the glory. I mean, there is an element of the glory of God that will come only when we push and push and push. There is a place that you will get with God just by entering yourself. And as we enter, each one, enter,
because of the abundance of the glory of God in this one, that one. You know, the tongues of fire, like for the apostles, because of all those tongues of fire, suddenly it just becomes an explosion, and that is revival. The other thing about revival is we must bear only the testimony of Jesus Christ. We must bear only the testimony of Jesus Christ. And what God has been challenging about, excuse me, is about the issue of you can't be born again, but you're walking in deliberate sin. You can't be born again and you're dating an unbeliever. You're unequally yoked. It's against the move of God, and God cannot even bless that kind of a situation. You cannot be born again and you're cohabiting with somebody. You don't, you know, if you have children now and everything, you know, you can repent and then just say, Lord, we want to live the right way, then solemnize that marriage. But you can't just deliberately sin, you know, and I'm talking about fornication, because unfortunately nowadays we have so many Christians sleeping with their BFF. You know, earlier on today we were discussing the issue of courtship. You know, Christians don't date. Christians court, and we're discussing the issue of you know, courtship, and you know, we don't date for sport. Yeah, you don't go like cute da, da 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 da. Okay, yeah, I like you. Yeah, let's go out, sasa. Let's go out. We date. We court with the intention of marriage. So that period is getting to know one another before now the proposal finally. But we don't hold hands. We don't kiss. We don't even hug, by the way, because we don't want to give the enemy a foothold to stand on. And but unfortunately, it's like that's not even being taught. You see, you know, by the way, the other day I saw a photo. I had to comment. You know, sometimes me, I can't hold back. So I saw a photo of, you know, worshippers. It was like a worship. You know, worshippers, by the way, you don't realize how Satan hates you. You know, that's the amazing thing. You're a worshiper. People tell you you're so anointed and everything. And also, I guess for the rest of us, we also don't pray for that person. So, you know, let's assume that this is one of the worshipers. Okay, I know I'm spoiling the set. Marie, please forgive me. But this is a worshiper standing here, eh? Male worshiper. But as a chick, we are taking a photo like this. Rubbing who? Touching who? With what? And you tell me you're worshipers. Rubbish. Total, utter rubbish. Yeah? I don't know whether that set was like that, but hopefully it was like that. Anywho, yeah. No, you guys stop throwing your two hands. Me, I'm just myself. So, people here were like, Pasi, yeah, no, guys, it's okay. We're keeping it real. So, those are the things, guys. Those are the things that we are looking at. Those are the things that are grieving the Holy Spirit. And you will not come into such an environment. And women are particularly guilty of that, you know, how we dress and everything. So what is God saying to us? Revelations 19:20. Remember, first was death. So even though you love showing your, you know, I call it baby's food, even though you love showing it, you begin to cover up because you realize, you know, it's going to stumble someone else, you know. And I know it's really nice and everything, but I don't need to be showing that side of me except in my bedroom with my husband, okay? When we are married in church, okay? And then, of course, bearing only the testimony of Jesus Christ, that when someone looks at you, by the way, I have shorts in my wardrobe and clothes in my wardrobe that I now need to give away because I'm like, I can't wear them. I love them, but I can't wear them. I'm going to look great in them if I wear them. But I can't wear them because, you know, I think the last time I wore shorts, I was in Mombasa. And, you know, the way you're feeling funky, that time I wasn't even quite fully, like, okay, there's no fully pastor. But I wasn't, like, you know, I guess known. Nowadays, I guess I meet people who are like, oh, you're so-and-so, you're so-and-so. But I'm in Mombasa, I'm chilled, I've let my hair loose. And then this girl came, pastor! Like, you know, so there's no, but and but even outside the country, you don't have that luxury. And the Holy Spirit has taught me there are things you can't do. Dead, yeah, you have to die to self and all the things you think and believe, and, you know, you might try to justify them till kingdom come, but the Holy Spirit tells you, no, you can't wear that, no. And then, of course, we must bear only the testimony of Jesus Christ. No one should look and say, you're saved. Okay, they'll do that sometimes, yeah? Sometimes people will just look at you and they think that, you know, you should be a shout to get saved because then, or ugly to get saved. I've had people go like, with all that beauty, you're saved, you know? And you're like, really? People are ugly and therefore that's when they get saved. I don't know what people expect. But really, we must bear only the testimony of Jesus to get revival. The other thing that God taught me was we must allow the incision of the cross. An incision means cutting. We must allow the cross to cut us. And that is Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I no longer live, but I've been crucified with Christ, and I therefore no longer live. Okay? I've been crucified with Christ. I no longer live. The life I live in the body, I live through the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. All right, so that's Galatians 2:20. So you allow that crucifixion, that cut of the cross, the incision of the cross, to cut, to search, to seek, and until you're changed. And then there's Acts chapter 2, verse 37. Okay? Acts chapter 2, verse 37. Then the other thing that God taught me is about deep calling unto deep at the noise of thy water sprouts. You know, deep calls to deep. So God is deep. So he calls you in because you're also deep. And the deeper you get, the deeper part of God you get. And this is Psalms 42, verse 7. Deep calls unto deep at the noise of thy water sprouts. And water sprouts are about water just pouring. And it's like the form of clouds that are heavy and pregnant. And then the glory of God just descends. So to get revival and to begin the journey of revival, you need a deep conviction that you need revival. You need a deep conviction that you need revival. I am convinced that there is no prayer we can pray for Kenya. That there is nothing we can say about Kenya. There is no fasting we can fast for Kenya. By the way, we have fasted and fasted and fasted all the way from last year until, by the way, today the Lord allowed me to fast, but mostly he's been telling me don't. Because, you know, like even the other day when we were doing Rutma 3, I could feel, in fact, I was like, I'm so unfit. Then the Holy Spirit said, no, it's your body that is weak from fasting. So I'm convinced that what we need, I have a deep conviction that what we need in this nation can only be sorted out by revival. A heavy outpour of God that will just cause people to fall on their knees and be convicted about the right thing to do. And only God can do that. So we need a deep conviction. And then number two, and you know, a deep conviction comes in that when you're crying for revival, by the way, married people, please prepare yourselves. The moment you begin to cry for revival, your marriage begins to fall apart. Yeah, and funny things begin to happen. You were happily married, everything was fine, and all of a sudden things begin to fall apart because the devil wants to stop you. Revival is fought, and you need to know that revival is fought. You need to be able to look at this spouse of yours and say, hey, ain't nothing that revival cannot sort out in all this. And then ignore the tantrums, and I'm not saying ignore your spouse because you must not, never ignore your spouse. You focus on revival and refuse every kind of sideshow. Your kids may start getting sick. Your business may start going down the drain. By the way, all these things I'm telling you, I have suffered in the pursuit of revival. And Satan will use this one, then use this one, then use this one, then use this one, then try all sorts of things. But you remain on the path because you have a deep conviction. You have a deep conviction. Out of the four things I said, the deep conviction is the first. The four things I said that God told me. You have to have a deep conviction that what is needed is revival. Sometimes revival can take many days. Last night I heard God saying, call an 100-day of prayer for revival. That in 100 days, all you're crying for is revival. And you know, there's some kids in a dormitory who just started. One started praying and saying, I'm calling for revival. Another one came in and said, we're calling for revival. And they ended up missing the semester as they were calling for revival because they wouldn't even remember to go for their classes. And you know, that's how revival is. You know, part of why I've resigned from my job is I need to focus on calling for revival. Because sometimes I've had situations where I can feel that the Lord wants me to call for revival. I'm at work. So what do I do? Go to the loo, put the loo down. But then how long can you stay in the loo, you know, with the knocks and everything, and also just the thought of I need to get back to my desk and do my work. Then you get back to your desk and like, karosha, tarara, and you know, the glory of God is moving. Then somebody walks in and you have to compose yourself because this is a secular environment. They cannot find you crying and looking like you're such a mess and everything. And how do you explain to them I'm crying for revival? You can't really say that, you know. And so for me, it just became untenable to be in a secular environment. I need to be in an environment where if God says go to the prayer mountain and call to me, if God says go to this forest and call unto me, I can be able to do that, and all I need to worry about is my children and my husband. You know, so deep conviction. The second thing is to recognize and acknowledge our own sin and failure. Part of how revival comes is that you must, and these are steps, by the way, okay? So first it's a deep conviction. Then the second thing is to realize there's no revival is going to come to this environment. We are sinful, we are greedy, we are corrupt, we are promiscuous. And by the way, this one comes with a lot of sadness. So you find yourself even in a matatu and you're crying. And people are thinking, eh, naka kakona mashida mingi. But really, it's about the glory of God and what God is doing. And it's okay, you learn. I mean, after all, you no longer live, isn't it? But Christ lives in you. So you're in a matatu. I've driven so many times crying and saying, oh my God, you know, and my husband, by the way, I thank God for my husband. I think he's seen it all, you know, and, you know, waking up in the middle of the night and I'm weeping, or I go to the sitting room and I'm wailing. Even my children have come to learn that my nanny, by the way, every morning my nanny wakes up and says, leo tunakula, you know, she doesn't know whether we are eating or not that day until I confirm to her that she rushes to go and prepare breakfast and all that. And this is now the realization of sin. You know, you look at dear daddy, who you found to be an amazing, perfect guy. And all of a sudden you look and the Holy Spirit begins to download things and you're on the floor. And the Lord begins with our households. Remember Jerusalem, yeah? Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria to the ends of the world, Acts 1:8. And you begin to weep. Then God reveals issues with your grandmother. God reveals issues with the great-grandparents. Remember, when you take responsibility for something, God begins to bring information. So it seems like, wow, us guys are gonna be destroyed. This is crazy. This is nuts. How can this be? How can God be in this situation? How, you know, and it's terrible. Then you move to your workplace and you begin to see things so differently, and what you're seeing is the sin, and you're repenting, and it's painful and it hurts. This stage hurts, and that's why you need stage one of the deep conviction, so that you're able, if things are thick, and you're like, I can't do this, this is too much. And remember, it's a lonely path. Sometimes people may not be there with you. Then you're able to go back again to stage one, the deep conviction, and not quit. So you need to recognize, acknowledge. So recognition means you note sin and call it sin. And then you acknowledge and you say, yes, Lord, we have sinned. And by then, let me tell you, the sin of President Uhuru becomes yours completely. God gives you information and you are, you know, instead of even judging him or saying or whatever it is, did I know? No. God has moved you to that place where you cry and you cry and you cry and you cry. And the beauty is, God gives information, but he can trust you with information. So there are things you will not say, you will not share to the wrong audience, because also you protect the information that God gives you, and you share only that which you need to give. Okay? So acknowledge, and then you, the own sin, your own sin. First of all, it begins with you yourself. Okay? Not outside. It begins with you yourself. And you're like, wow, God, I am fallen. God, I am sinful. God, I have done. And you're able to repent. Stage three is repentance and crying. I guess stage two. And so stage two is recognize and acknowledge your own sin and failure. Okay? So it begins with your own, and then you move to other people. Stage three is you repent and you weep to God for mercy. Okay? Jeremiah talks about the wailing women. You weep to God for mercy because you see the sin the way God sees it. You realize how that sin affects the kingdom of God. You realize one of the things that God has taught me over the last, 5 years, is that when I do well, when I do the right thing, when I obey God, like for example, when we did the Rutma 3, which, like I shared, it was really, really hard. I can't wait for the next one. But just that, Jesus is seated on the right-hand side of the Father Almighty, and heaven turns to him and tells him, this is why you died. So you exalt the lamb that was slain when you do the right thing. Sometimes it's hard. You may have to break off a relationship that is sinful. It is hard. You may have to shut a business. I remember a lady who touched my heart so greatly because she came with some papers and she told me, Pastor Kathy, you have said that there are businesses that may have to shut down. An apostle, my business, I didn't do it the right way. And I brought these papers. I just wanted you to pray over them because I have to gain the courage to go and shut down this business. And she went ahead and shut. And I was so amazed through repentance and believing God to do something new. And you don't go consulting because people think you're mad. But God has said you must. You know, I've had things even in my house that I've had to get up and remove after I got married because I knew the way I got them. And God said, this cannot be in my house. This one, clothes, shoes, perfumes, throwing away. Because I know that at this point in my life I was rebelling and I did not acquire it the right way. And that's part of the repentance process, turning away. Not easy. And I'm not telling you to leave your husband, to leave your wife, God, unless God has spoken very clearly, God hardly ever tells you to leave a husband or a wife, even if they're not born again, by the way. You need to go and read 1 Corinthians chapter 7 if you have a marriage situation, all right? So then the fourth thing is to let the cross of Jesus Christ cut you deep. So there are four things that God summarized for me. And this is a realization of who God is and who we are. So this story of calling God in Jesus, IJN, like he's your little BFF, yeah? Like he's at his God, you know? At my beshte. You begin to get a realization of who God is and who we are in God. And there are things and there are places you won't go purely because of this realization. There are things you can't do purely because of this realization. So it stops from being, you know, I'm born again, and meokoka, praise God. And your testimony goes ahead of everything. Because remember, we must bear the testimony of God. Just to go back again, it's a deep conviction, that is point one. You need a deep conviction that you need revival. And the nation needs revival and the place needs revival. Then you need to recognize, acknowledge, and own, as in to possess, your own sin and take responsibility for it and every failure in your life. Then move from there to your family, move from there to the company where you work, move from there to the nation and the tribe and everything and all those things. By tribe, I'm referring to your family, really. I'm not talking about tribalism, but even that too. Yeah, your village and all that. And basically you begin to just repent the Maduong way, you know, big repentance, serious repentance. But you're owning, you're possessing. And let me tell you something about this stage. As you move to stage two and stage three, stage three is repent and cry to God for mercy and turn away. Stage two and three, you watch news, you begin to cry. God, they did what to a child? Oh my God, Lord, we have sinned. We are molesting children, Jehovah, forgive us. Oh God, where have we reached? So you don't move. But then if you're still at that stage of dunya imeisha, dunya imeisha, you're not there. You're not there. But if you're at that place where you see a child has been, God, God, what can I do? Is there something personal that I can do, God? God, oh, that baby, wherever they are, God, may they forgive us. Oh, no, Jehovah, God, why are we doing this to children, Father? You know that repentance, God, may no other child be raped. May another child be molested. Lord Jehovah, someone cut the hands of a woman. Oh, Jehovah God, forgive us. You know, you're not even a man, but you're weeping and you're repenting for the sin. And by the way, I'm crying. Tell you, I could have been in Hollywood. Maybe one of these days someone will discover me. Anyway, so then, so there is repent and cry to God for mercy, turn away. And then there's verse 4. Ati verse 4. Yani, naitwa kukua shipiri until even numbers are verses. Yeah, reminds me of the time the other day I answered my phone. I said, hallelujah. I just started laughing, really. Then verse, so point number 4 is, let the cross of Jesus Christ cut you deep. And this means a realization of who God is and a realization of who we are in God. I think time is up and we need to spend some time in prayer. And I would like to discuss about the results of revival, but I think we'll do that next Sunday, okay? So we'll discuss the results of revival, and these are 6 particular results that God gave me, and we will do that on part 2. So allow me to stop there. And imagine my phone, which is still not showing anything, is actually telling me battery low. Yeah, new shetani nimbaya. So we'd like to pray together and pray for the needs on the land. Livy, Hollywood, eh? Oh yeah, you know that, isn't it? Utaokoka jo. Wataokoka. Yeah. Amen. All right, guys. So let's take some time and pray for people. As usual, we like to pray for the sick. I owed you a testimony. So today someone told me, here's what the Holy Ghost does, guys. Eh? Don't joke with the Holy Spirit. And especially the people of God. What? So this lady shares that she got a phone call. She loves the Lord deeply, walking with the Lord. We're on this revival journey together. So she says, shares that she got a phone call from her nanny telling her that KPLC guys have come and they've disconnected her electricity. Yeah, she has paid. So she starts to pray dangerous prayers, declaring what? Cut my leg. What? And I have paid. I have no balance. I have nothing. Shatorama sekerebo. You're joking with dangerous prayers. Do you know, when she arrived at home, the KPLC vehicle that had been disconnecting the electricity was stuck in the mud.
And after they reconnected her power, she released it.
Yeah, reminds me of Elisha. Baldi, baldi, kiparangoto. We have authority. When you're walking with God, you have authority. People feared the God of Israel and the people of Israel. People cannot be messing around with us to disconnecting your power. So people can be like, I wanna kwanga nashida, and then she saved. Nashita is, never ever. God will not allow it. So anyway, I had to share that particular testimony. So Natasha Joy says, mention my name in prayer. Amen. Amen. Oh, Magda, thank you. Thank you. The beautiful set, she's saying, beautiful set. The Holy Spirit is telling me to look up. Yes, I need to look up, apparently. Yeah, I'm being coached by the Spirit of God. He's amazing. So pray for my eyes. They are deeply hurting. Okay, all right. So, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we mention Natasha Joy before you, oh God. Whatever her need is, whatever the issue is, oh Father God, in the name of Jesus. Show yourself, God, as the one who answers prayer, as the one who shows up in that situation, Lord. We love you, King of Glory, and we thank you even as you attend to our sister, oh God. Lee says, my eyes are hurting deeply. My God, I thank you because this is not Liz's portion for her eyes to hurt, oh God. Lord, as you healed my eyes last year, Liz, I just want to mention that sometimes eyes, an attack on your eyes can also be an attack on your prophetic gifting, because the enemy can try that. At some point, by the way, I was hit even with blindness. In fact, one of the videos that I did on Revival in August last year, I couldn't see. I couldn't see. And for quite a while, I couldn't see. I was just in black, but I continued to preach anyway. I didn't even say anything, and then my vision came back. So sometimes the attack is that. And in the name of Jesus, we rebuke whatever is attacking this woman's eyes, and we command it to be gone. In the name of Jesus Christ, we speak peace. We speak shalom. Oh, Holy Spirit, thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Spirit of the living God, as you just apply your healing balm of Gilead upon this dear woman's eyes in the name of Jesus Christ. There shall be no pain. There shall be no torment. There shall be no attack in the name of Jesus Christ. Oh, thank you for the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. Being applied in that particular situation and that attack of the enemy in Jesus' name. Terry Ongamo is laughing because of KPLC. Oh, yeah. All right, so Glenn Minor, still believing with you for Dad's interview. And right now, in the name of Jesus, I know there are some people on this platform that try to spy and to nullify things. I declare that nothing shall touch this particular young man's family in the name of Jesus Christ. And Father, you're making a way for Glenn, oh Lord God, and the dad, and they will rejoice and be glad. And we've been hearing testimonies of what you're doing out there as we're praying with people, oh Lord. My Father, my King, I know that you hear me, oh God. Step into that situation, my Father, and give this man this job, oh God. And if not this particular one, Father, astound them with greater. But God, I feel you witnessing about this particular one, my God. Father God, this is a young teenager who's walking with you, oh Lord God, and loving you and glorifying you. Even the other day, the mom called me, oh God. And Lord, I thank you because instead of being caught up with funny things, Lord, he chooses to come onto this platform and to seek after you. And Lord, I bless you for little Glenn. Lord, you're gonna use him. You're gonna, oh, I feel the anointing, Glenn. The Lord's gonna use you. The Lord's gonna raise you up. I see you doing great things as you're going back to, oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for that confirmation. As you're going back to school, you're going to have an anointing of knowing things, a very prophetic gifting upon you, and even being able to lay hands on people, and things will begin to happen. Glenn, prepare yourself and walk in humility. Don't be like I was when I was about your age. I was young and foolish, and I lost that particular anointing. I've had to really pray for the Lord to restore that. So Glenn, take that, run with it. Take that, run with it. If I go hold daddy right now and declare, and it shall be with you according to what the Lord says in the name of Jesus. I feel a very heavy anointing on you, Glenn. I can't wait to meet you. I hope you'll be able to come to church soon. That anointing I've just felt, God doesn't do that with just everybody. Eric Mbaya, you are supposed to come to church. Okay, so let's see. Let us grow in the Lord. TBN is waiting for you, Apostle. Amen, Eric. Amen. 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 Lona Omboy, laughing her eyes out, all right. Edmond Mwangele, remember. Needing deliverance. Edmond, you need to come for the Sozo session if you're in the country, okay? 25th of November, don't be late. You need to come. Sozo, the Sozo session. We have Sozo Church, which is Sunday, and then you have Tuesday. But 25th of November is purely deliverance and healing. Miraculous. The Lord moves in heavy ways. You need to come. God's going to do it for you. you will prophesy. You will testify, sorry. Maybe prophesy too, but you will testify. You can read the testimony of the guy there who, there's a guy who put his testimony today, and I attached it today when I was doing the invite. If you haven't seen it, together with like the woman with the issue of blood reaching out, there is a testimony there of somebody who was touched in a major way for deliverance, and God did amazing things. True story. Sylvia, Lord, in the name of Jesus, we speak healing upon Sylvia and anyone who's not feeling well in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord God, right now, Sylvia Chemon, just receive healing in the name of Jesus. Receive healing in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and King. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Father. You're good. You're good, oh God. Thank you. You're changing her life as well, oh Father. Oh, thank you, King of Glory. She's encountering you in a new way, oh God. Hallelujah. You're visiting her, oh God, even in dreams and in visions, oh God. Oh, Susan, you can feel the presence of the Lord right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. The Lord is touching you. I can feel some heat along the hands. So Sylvia, I believe that's the Lord touching you right now. Hallelujah. Betty's watching. God bless you, Betty. Betty Furaha. Susan Gillian says, please pray for my brother. He needs a job. Thank you, Father. We pray for all who are looking for jobs, oh God, and some sustenance. Lord, we thank you because our jobs are not our source. And Lord God, we thank you even for the provision that you've given for this brother, even up to now, Lord Jehovah God. And in the process of job seeking, oh Lord Jehovah, may he encounter you in a mighty way and as a provider, oh Lord Jehovah God. And even for all those who are looking for jobs, my Father, make a way where there seems to be no way. My Father, remove, oh God, the wicked that use their position in the wrong way, my Father. Remove them from office and place your children there, Lord. And may your children learn to be faithful in their jobs, my Father, my God. Even as Christians, may we learn to be faithful with that which our hand has found to do. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lea Gashao says, yeah, Nyaga Murugi says we need revival. Amen. That's conviction, Nyaga. So let's call to the Lord for revival. And it's persistence, just calling on the name of the Lord. Lea Gashao says, pray for my right leg. It's been hurting. Leah, just put your hand on that right leg right now. Put your hand on that right leg right now and just believe, okay? Just believe. Rako shandere kashororobo. Inda kashorobaseke rebozaya. Ranti rabaseta. Right leg, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to be made right now and to align yourself to the will of Jehovah. Her legs are supposed to be for glorifying God, beautiful feet that publish peace. So right now, in the name of Jesus Christ, we declare that and we decree it right now and speak healing by the powerful and mighty name of Jesus Christ and even by his 39 stripes. Shalom. Amen. Amen. As the Lord does it, please testify, guys. Pray for this pain to disappear. Nez, right now in the name of Jesus, we speak to that pain in the name of Jesus. You pain that dares to even attack somebody when they're in the middle of church. How dare you, Satan? Spirit of infirmity, we rebuke you. Get off Nez Minor now in the name of Jesus Christ. I don't care what you're using. I speak the blood of Jesus Christ. And Nez Minor reported here unto service to glorify the Lord. And you're not welcome here, you demons of sickness and pain in the name of Jesus Christ. How dare you try to exalt yourselves above the name of Jesus Christ. I pull you down now, I bind you, and I command you to the feet of Jesus Christ right now. How dare you try to compete with the Lord Jesus Christ? Hallelujah. I speak healing right now on you, Nez Minor, in the name of Jesus Christ. Kate Kinyua, pray for my colleague whose dad has been in ICU for 2 weeks. My Father, oh Lord God, oh my Father, visit the ICUs, oh God, and the HGUs, my God, and hospitals, my Father, as well as those who are sick and have been told that they are going to die, my Father, my God. It ain't over until you say it's over. Even these ICU bugs we've been hearing about, that people are going to hospital and they are getting sick there in hospital and getting conditions, my Father, my God. In the name of Jesus, we speak the blood of Jesus right now, wiping away every germ, every sickness, and every opportunistic thing that the enemy is trying to use. Oh, my Father, my God, we speak the blood of Jesus Christ into those IV needles and those IV drips in the name of Jesus Christ. Let the blood of Jesus trickle now, oh Lord Jehovah God, and go into every cell in the name of Jesus, renewing, reviving, oh Lord Jehovah God, that the doctors will not even know what's going on, my God. Father, we are waiting for that news article where the doctors are saying something amazing is happening to people in hospital, oh God, because I feel you're saying we're going to see that news, oh God, in the name of Jesus, as they say, people just began to be healed. Father, they're going to try and figure out, is it this medicine? Is it this thing, my Father? But even when they put them on just glucose alone, Father, people will stand up and get up and be healed and prophesy and glorify you, my God. Hallelujah. Let people arise from ICU with testimonies. Let them praise you. Let them come and talk about heaven. Let them come and talk about hell. Let them come and preach the gospel, Father, as you give them a second opportunity. Thank you, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And with that, Lord, you're reminding me, oh God, to pray for those who are mourning, oh God, and have lost loved ones in the name of Jesus. Encourage them, strengthen them, oh God. And Father, we know that you don't waste any experience. So be glorified, be magnified. Oh, Daddy, we love you. Oh God, who would we go to without you? Thank you, Jesus, for what you've done for us. That we can come in such an easy way and just declare your name and mention the cross and mention your blood. And it's done for us. Thank you, Jehovah. Hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Kate, can you just ask your colleague to go to hospital? I hope your colleague is born again. If she's not born again, please lead her to Christ. She needs to give her life to Christ. And then go to hospital and read Bible verses. Just read the Bible for her dad. He will rise. The Lord has said that. Okay. Jerry says, trusting God for a good report from my biopsy test. Absolutely, Jerry. It is done. It is done. We've been praying. We've been praying, honey. We've been praying. We've been praying. I can't believe that the devil tried stories of biopsy on you. How dare he? How dare he, in the name of Jesus Christ? How dare he? Father, won't you just deal with those demons that are trying to bring issues into Jerry's life in Jesus' mighty name. Eric Ma says, my testimony is that we prayed for the sick some weeks back, and I mentioned that my father had an issue with high blood pressure. Praise the living God, my father has recovered and was even able to attend church. Oh, I love this. And I don't know why this thing won't open for me to read the whole testimony. Shindwe, why? Okay. Anyway, it is done. And it's high blood pressure, by the way. One of those conditions you're told you'll live with for the rest of your life. Said who? Said who? He who gave you that heart is able to change it. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I hope, Eric, you've told your dad that you are praying and that this is the presence of God and his glory. And please get him onto this platform. No, no, a smartphone. No, Mwanesha, how to log in. Okay? We bless the Lord. We bless the Lord. And then, Eric, wherever he goes to church, please take a thanksgiving offering to the Lord and just say thank you to the Lord for what he's done. Kweba Mutembe says, please pray for a friend whose business is about to be auctioned, and this has drained their health as well. Favor, are they born again? You know, with finances, if somebody's not a tither, it's a bit difficult to just declare things. Eh? But anyway, I will pray by faith. But normally when it's someone tithes, when someone gives to the Lord, it's easier to just declare their tithe as blessing. But otherwise, then it might be a God robber situation. But anyway, I'm going to pray. So Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for this friend who's having a business problem, oh God, that even seems to be on the verge of being auctioned. And they're even getting to the point where it's weighing down on their health. Father God, I ask that they would encounter you who own silver and gold and cattle on 1,000 hills, oh Lord Jehovah God, and that you turn things around, oh Lord Jehovah God, even as they realize what the enemy has used, oh God, in this situation. For Lord God, you never allow businesses to shut down if you are at the center of them, unless it's a season or a time and you want to do something greater. In Jesus' name, amen. Penny Modoni says, my right eye has had issues since I began following your teachings. And she's laughing her eyes out. Ishindwe katika jina la Yesu. You right eye, I don't know what you have been covenanted to. I don't know what the enemy is holding against that right eye. But in the name of Jesus Christ, that right eye is for Jesus. Very much like the left eye as well. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord has spoken also about this woman and about her calling and her anointing. And so I command you to be made whole in Jesus' name. Amen. Penny, just hold it and declare, I am healed in Jesus' name. I like that you're laughing about it because it means also you have revelation that God has already done it. All right. Chichi says, Pastor Kathy, pray for a healing. Amen. Just speaking healing right now to you, Chichi, in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. And I think you're the Chichi that we're supposed to be working with soon because those names are looking very familiar. Chichi is also a very rare name. So call me as well, Chichi, because, I mean, we are in contact with one another if you're the right Chichi. Amen. Favor Wanjiko Motembe says, I'm believing God for this cabin crew job. Favor, did I not send you a photo and say that's you?
So it's done in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Glory to God. In cabin crew uniform. Hallelujah. Glory to God. The only thing, Favor, you need to know is these pilots have a code of sexual harassment and all that stuff. So may the Lord use you in that environment not to be, you know, confused. Yeah. Alrighty. Then Jillian Kero says, please pray the Kenyans in Dallas, for the Kenyans in Dallas, Texas. Many sudden deaths and sicknesses, really? Actually, I think it's something that's happening in America. A lot of Kenyans in America and people who are not from America are coming back in coffins. So actually, let's take some time and pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, as America has been such a Babylon, oh God, that's turning back to you, oh Lord Jehovah God, we refuse that it would vomit out Kenyans in the name of Jesus Christ and other nationalities, oh God, that have gone as missionaries. And we refuse, oh God, that they'll come back in coffins in the name of Jesus Christ. We refuse every form of death in the name of Jesus Christ. That altar that is America, we speak to you right now. You will obey the Lord. You'll bow before the Lord and you will not destroy people who have come there with the good news in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and King. Amen. You know, it's interesting that part of what the Lord said with the prophecy of Donald Trump was run, get out of there. A lot of people, you know, God was saying that, run, get out of there, get out of America. Yeah. Noni Kuria said, I pray that the precious Holy Spirit will continue to teach me more on revival. Amen. Amen. He will. He will, Noni. Just ask him to. He will. He's amazing. Pastor Kathy, pray for me, Olive, for my breakthrough to open my eyes and understanding to open, to completely walk in the Spirit. Lord God, won't you do it for Olive in the name of Jesus Christ, oh God. And in that process, oh God, of your glory falling, won't you cause her to receive breakthrough, oh Lord Jehovah God, because it's in that process that you release breakthrough, oh God. Thank you for everyone that's asking for prayer for healing. Lord God, patience is looking for healing in the name of Jesus. Touch her and heal her. Wamoyo Iregi says she receives healing in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Father God, everyone who's looking for healing, Monica Wanjiro, Lord God, we've believed for jobs and we enjoin her husband in the name of Jesus Christ. Grace Shalom is saying revival is starting with me. Glory to God. Aunt Jeff says, pray for my son, Lloyd, who is complaining of headache for quite a long time. Are you near your son, Anne? Are you near your son, Anne? It would be good. If you're near your son, just hold him right now. Rande Rakashi Ribo Sandararasi. Intercessors, just stretch out your hands towards Lloyd by faith in the name of Jesus Christ. Yeah. Father, we refuse that this child would be sick, oh God. Every form of tumor, every attack of the enemy, Lord, every nerve issue that may be affecting his head, in the name of Jesus, we command it to be gone now. That demon of torment, we command you to leave this little boy in the name of Jesus Christ, this young son. Oh, every form of witchcraft, every hold of the enemy, as he's taken to hospital tomorrow, they will find nothing, but also he will be healed in the name of Jesus Christ. It will stop. There will even be no need to take him to hospital in the name of Jesus Christ. Yahweh, you are the healer. Oh, Lord Jesus Christ, right now, we command that head, oh God. We command, oh Lord Jehovah God, his entire vertebrae, oh God, and even his spine, the spinal fluid right now to be normalized in the name of Jesus Christ. Akorase tarabazaya rando kitare kosada bazinta. Every sickness, meningitis, in the name of Jesus, we rebuke you. Every form of attack, in the name of Jesus, we rebuke you in the name of Jesus Christ. Every nerve issue, in the name of Jesus, we arise against you and we declare that you shall not stand. You have no hold in the name of Jesus Christ. Nanto katerebo zataria katerebo zaya. Thank you, Jehovah. The Lord says it is done. The Lord says it is done in Jesus' name. So, and just believe it. It is done in Jesus' name. Amen. Grace Kemby says, I receive it for my brother. Eliza is watching us from the Netherlands. Amen. Joseph is just acknowledging that he learns a lot. Glory be to the name of the Lord. He teaches us. Sometimes by there I speak things and I hear them for the first time. So it's all the Holy Spirit. I'm just a vessel and I just bless God. He's amazing. Liz desires to serve God and win souls for his kingdom and come through me. Hallelujah. Lord God, you've heard that. You've heard that. Ha. Lord God, there is a laborer. There is a laborer right there, oh God. Let your anointing fall upon Liz now in the name of Jesus and let her go out in Jesus' name. We commission you, Liz, in Jesus' name and we cover you with the blood of Jesus Christ. Terry Ongamo says, my prayer is to be able to speak in tongues and receive the Holy Spirit. Terry, Okay, all right, okay. In the name of Jesus, may you receive Terry. But when you come to church next time, just mention it and we'll just pray with you in the name of Jesus. Jeff Corey is shouting, amen, shalom, hallelujah. Okay, Susan Gillian, amen. Glenn Minor, thank you, Jesus Christ, amen, amen. Glenn has shikad that word, he's run with it. Glenn, you'll be such a joy to your mama. You'll be such a joy to your parents and your family. Oh, firebrand for Jesus. Again, I'm feeling the Holy Spirit when I speak about Glenn. Wow. Wow. Glenn, won't you come to church? I would love to meet you. I would really love to meet you. I like seeing when I hear the Holy Spirit so heavily. If you're in Nairobi, please come. I would like to see you. I would like to see you, and I can't wait to hear more. Amen. Amen. He says he'll visit together with his family. I'm a hugger, so if I come and run and hug you, don't be shocked, okay? All right. I think the food is cooking. Edmond says, pray for me. Pray for me in capital letters, my financial situation and my business to flourish. And I am a little far from your church. Okay, Edmond, in the name of Jesus, may the Lord come through for you. I believe you're a tither. I believe you're also giving to the house of the Lord. So we speak the blessing of the tither in the name of Jesus Christ. And we just speak, you know, new business ideas and things that will, you know, outdo anyone who's the competition or anything like that. And whatever Satan is using to try and take hold of your finances, in the name of Jesus, every spirit of poverty, it shall not follow you. It ends. It ends with your parents. It shall not follow you in the name of Jesus Christ, and you shall not struggle in Jesus' name. Mudoni Davy says, you skip me. Sorry, dear. Please pray. I'm waiting for an opening. Also healing for my mom. Amen. We've prayed for jobs, honey. We prayed for jobs. So, Lord, we just speak that you would heal Mudoni's mama and sister, and that, Lord God, that you would also come through for her, oh God, in terms of a job opening. I believe that's what she means in the name of Jesus Christ. You can also text me in terms of if you're looking for a job, guys, and let us know what your skills are, because sometimes, yes, there's prayer, but we can't be able to connect you to someone who's looking for a job, okay? And when you get jobs, please work. Okay, by the Christians, ebule, work. Let's work. Let's work, okay? When we get jobs, let's be faithful with our jobs. All right, my sister just started a business for sustenance and resources. Okay, I think the thing has just died now, like whatever was left. Yeah, so amen. We are praying, Lorna, for your sister in the name of Jesus Christ. May the Lord make a way where there seems to be no way. Encourage your sister also to just be a giver wherever she fellowships, and for God to make a way for her. God will make a way in Jesus' name. Okay, guys, I think we have to stop at this point. I've seen colon cancer somewhere. We rebuke it in the name of Jesus Christ. We rebuke it in the name of Jesus Christ. Feet swelling. Oh, Lord Jehovah, won't you touch and heal, oh God? There's nothing you cannot do, Papa. Cancer is just a name. Oh God, sicknesses are just names, oh God. There's nothing you cannot do, God. Hallelujah. Nema is trusting God for increase. I can barely see. Wow. In the Lord name of Jesus, Lord, every prayer mentioned here, my Father, my God, may you come through, O God. May you come through in the name of Jesus Christ. And refuse every counterattack in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father God, even for our Kenyans also who are outside the country, can put it on charger. For Kenyans who are outside the country, Father God, minister to them in the name of Jesus Christ. Strengthen them, O God. There are others as well, Lord God, who are not able to mention their needs on this platform. But Lord, they are crying to you. You know what their needs are. And guys, just write down whatever you've prayed for so that you can notice and recognize when God comes through, so that you can know what it looks like and also give thanks. We highly encourage that when God does something for you, you take an offering to the house of the Lord, wherever it is that you fellowship, and you just say, God, this is my thanksgiving to you, and I've brought it into the house of the Lord. Amen. God bless you. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you for being with us the last 2 hours. Can you imagine? Yeah, the Holy Spirit really moves when you're having a good time. So it's been 2 hours, and let's just take some time and thank God. Thank you, Father. You're a good Father. You're so faithful. You're so worthy. We thank you, Lord. All this is your doing, Father. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for who you've been to us, oh God. And we thank you because you show up, oh God, every time. Father God, may we never bring you shame, but every time, oh God, may our lives be a testimony of your glory, oh God. We pray for revival, Lord, and we ask, Lord, that we forget our selfishness and truly pray for revival in the name of Jesus Christ. I'm seeing somebody being delivered right now. Someone is being delivered right now. I'm just seeing something that looks like it's coming from the hand. and just coming out right now in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, for that deliverance that you're doing right now in the name of Jesus Christ, and even dealing with that demonic entity that I've just seen that looks like a form of claws. Thank you, Lord, because you're so faithful, oh God. Father God, it touches us about how eager you are, oh God, to bless us, oh Lord. How you're always looking for an opportunity to be a blessing to us, Lord. God, teach us to love you. Teach us to love you, God. God, if we can only learn to love you the way you love us, oh God, won't you teach us, Lord? We are so often caught up in discouragement, so often caught up in distractions. Sometimes we are so caught up in our blessings, oh God. Oh Lord, we pray for marriages, oh Lord Jehovah God. When things get rosy or when we get married, we forget you, oh Lord Jehovah God. We pray for jobs and then we forget to go to church and we forget, oh God, to go for fellowship and even to thank you. When we finally have, oh God, forgive us, Lord. We thank you because you understand that we're a frame of dust, oh God. We thank you, Lord God, because we carry anointing, oh God, in these jars of clay that are our bodies, oh Lord Jehovah God. But even then, Lord, we don't want to use the fact that we are clay as a crutch. Father God, you said that Job was blameless. God, may we be blameless. There was no blood of Jesus at the time, and yet he was blameless. Lord, we ask you, may we be blameless like Job was blameless, oh God. May you be pleased with us, oh God. May we be men and women after your heart, oh God, like the way the men of old were and the women of old were. Father God, the things of earth are so fleeting. Won't you teach us, oh God, to just leave them, oh God, and choose you. Oh God, you're worth so much more than gold. You're worth so much more than silver. We love you, Lord. Just to hold on to you, Lord God, is so much more where you bless us from, and yet we give up, oh God, when you're just getting started. And we get fooled by the enemy and deceived and swayed. Lord, teach us to love you. Teach us for our love for you to be real. From deep down, oh God, a love that cannot be moved from you. And we thank you that nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. God, may nothing separate you from our love either, oh Lord God, in Christ Jesus. We love you, Lord. Always be the center, Lord. I'm just close with a word of worship. Jesus, at the center of it all. Jesus, at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be. It's always been you, Jesus. Jesus. Just be the center of my life. Jesus, be the center of my life. And every knee will bow. And every tongue shall confess you, Jesus. Jesus. At us. Nothing in this world will do. Jesus, you're the center. Everything revolves around you, Jesus, you. So Jill says, sorry guys, I'm trying to gesture and I tell guys I cannot read lips. Jill says, the pain has disappeared. Glory to Jesus. Thank you, Father. We bless you, Lord. We give you thanks, oh God, for that is your doing. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you. Dear ones, I met a lady who told me that God is doing such amazing things in her life. And she told me she does everything she is told that she should do whenever I say do this. These things cannot manifest unless you obey. When we say stop sinning, don't look to the left or to the right. If you do that, if we say pray without ceasing, we say fast, call on the name of God, read the Bible, these are biblical tenets. And what we're doing is giving you spiritual coaching. Things that we have tried and we've seen God do it, and God does it. He's not a respecter of persons. I'm being reminded that we need to do an altar call. Is there anyone who would like to give their life to Jesus? I'll just give it a minute or so. But also, if you're a little shy, you can text us and we'll actually call you and lead you to Christ, no matter where you are, no matter which part of the world. And the Holy Spirit is reminding me there's someone in Dubai with roommates. And I keep trying to call you and you have your roommates and you're unable to. We need to do that altar call thing and pray together when your roommates are not around. But maybe your roommates need to see you receiving Jesus, really. Yeah. It's time for salvation. It's time for salvation. Sometimes it's in the middle of the street. Is there anyone who would like to give their life to Jesus? If you say me, I will know that what you mean is giving your life to Jesus, okay? If you type just M-E. Amen. 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 So if you'd like to receive Jesus, you can still text us. The number is on the screen, top right-hand corner. If you'd also like to give to the ministry, as the Lord moves your heart to do, because we depend, of course, on the giving of the saints, then you can also give. And that number is a Kenyan number, +254. Amen, amen, amen. Yeah, so let's do what we are asked to do. And Jane Mongara will speak healing for you in the name of Jesus Christ. Just believe that you're healed. We've prayed for everyone who is unwell, and just believe. The same way that Liz was healed, then you're also healed in the name of Jesus Christ. Same God, same God. Somebody help me sing it, that song of, if he did it for me, he'll do it for you. Can't help, can't help talking about everything is done. Is the best thing that happens since the world begun. It didn't come cheap, but I got it for free. He's the hope of glory, Christ in me. Taught me to sing when my spirit was blind. It's amazing when it looks just what you find. Everything take he took two. If he did it for me, he can do it for you. Do you know him? Do you know what he says is true? Aha! Do you know him? Yes, I do. If he did it for me, he can do it for you. That's one of the things I really believe in. You know, we're just here people from Lighty days, eh? Just declaring a very old song. But it's one of the things I declare. The same God who did it for them will do it for you and will do it for me in the name of Jesus Christ. God bless you. Good night, saints of God. Good night, everybody. And good night also to those who spy on this page. You will be arrested by Jesus and give your life to Christ. We love you too. In Jesus' name, amen.